Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the fifth meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. Today's only business is an evidence session from the President-designate of COP26, the Right Honourable Alok Sharma MP, who is joined today by three colleagues: Peter Hill, COP26 Chief Executive Officer; Wassim Mir, COP26 Chief Operating Officer; and Lee McDonough, Director General, Net Zero and International at the Department for Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy. Mr. Sharma, we know that you have an extremely busy schedule with your preparations for the COP26 summit, so we are extremely grateful for you and your colleagues joining us this morning. I understand that you would like to begin by making an opening statement, so I will hand over to you at this stage. Thank you.
Great. Well, thank you very much indeed, Chair. It's a pleasure to be here, and obviously I have Peter Hill and Wassim Mir from the COP unit, who will help me answer any questions you may have related to COP and our international engagement and logistics and all of those issues. And of course, Lee McDonough from BEIS, who leads on net zero strategy. And I'm sure we'll be happy to address any questions you have on domestic or BEIS related policy. So I guess from my perspective, as the COP president designate and as part of the COP unit, we have been doing a significant amount of international engagement in terms of preparing for COP26, which is now, of course, less than 2 months away. And I think just be useful briefly to set out what it is that we are hoping to get out of COP in terms of targets that the world can aim for. Your committee members will be aware that back in 2015 in Paris, world leaders agreed that they would work to ensure that average global temperature rises were limited to well below 2 degrees, aiming for 1.5. And I think the overarching message that we would like to get out of COP is that we have kept 1.5 within reach. Your committee members will also have seen the IPCC report that came out in August, which painted a pretty stark picture of where we are. And basically saying that the door, the window is basically closing on 1.5, but there is still room if countries act now. And as part of the message that I've been taking to every country, there are four things that we are asking them to do. One is on mitigation, so ambitious 2030 emission reduction targets and net zero commitments for the middle of the century. Now, we have made some progress there. All the G7 have committed to net zero by 2050, but also 2030 targets, which align with net zero. And when we took on the COP26 presidency, less than 30% of the global economy was covered by a net zero target. We're now at 70%. But we still need other countries, particularly some of the G20 nations, which have not yet come forward with ambitious 2030 emission reduction targets, to come forward. The second thing we're asking countries to do is to set out plans for adapting to the climate change that is already happening. And as we saw from the IPCC report, even if global warming stopped tomorrow, climate change stopped tomorrow, the effects of what has happened already will continue to reverberate for a long period of time. So countries need to plan for that. Thirdly, we are asking developed countries to deliver on their promise of $100 billion a year funds mobilization to support developing countries. That was supposed to happen every year from 2020 to 2025. We are not there yet. We've had some new money that has been announced, significant new money that's been announced by a number of countries, but clearly we need to do more. So we're continuing to press the donor countries on this, and we're going to be setting out a delivery plan ahead of COP on this. And the final piece of the puzzle from our perspective is closing off the remaining outstanding items on the Paris rulebook. There are detailed rules still after 6 years that have not been resolved in a number of areas, and we hope that that is something that we can reach agreement on. And the final thing I want to say in this opening statement is that I very much want to see this as an all of UK COP, something that we can all collectively be very proud of. And of course, we will be welcoming the world to Glasgow. And I think this is an opportunity to showcase what the United Kingdom also has to offer. And we've been working very hard, obviously, on the logistics of making sure this is a safe and secure event. And I'm sure we'll address that through the questions of this committee. Thank you very much for that, Chair.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sharma, for your opening remarks, which provide an excellent overview for this session. We will now move to questions from the committee. And my first question is something you alluded to in your opening remarks about what we might expect to see from COP26 in terms of what will be the key indicators of success that we will be looking for coming from the conference. And is it right to say that there is, this time around, Can you hear me now, Mr. Sharma?
We can't hear the chair at all.
Bear with us a second and we will try to fix this. We'll suspend the meeting for a short time. Okay, Mr. Sharma, can you hear me now?
I can indeed, Chair. Yes, indeed.
Excellent. Apologies for that technical issue. My first question related to the indicators of success we may look out for coming from the conference. You alluded to some of these in your opening remarks, but I wonder if you could talk a bit more about what those key indicators of success will be, because my understanding is there's quite a wide range of criteria and objectives that all parties are looking to achieve, including the international climate financial support you mentioned, nationally determined contributions from each of the states, and the sharing of low carbon technology and policy platforms with developing nations. I wonder if you could touch on some of those issues, please.
Yes, of course. So I think in terms of the overall indication of success, as I said, I think what we will want coming out of this is for independent parties to be able to say that we have kept 1.5 within reach. And you mentioned, Chair, the NDCs. Obviously, we've now had, I think, well over 100 countries that have come forward with NDCs. But obviously, there are almost 200 parties which have signed up to the Paris Agreement. And some of the biggest economies in the world, some of the biggest G20 nations have not yet come forward with revised NDCs. And, I was at the July ministerial meeting of the climate and energy ministers in Naples. And as part of the communique, there was an agreement that every G20 nation would step forward with enhanced NDCs before COP26. So, we're waiting to see what comes out of that. And obviously at the UN General Assembly next week, there is an opportunity for countries to make further announcements. But I think it's also going to be quite important that we get further net zero commitments. I do think we've made significant progress going from 30% of global GDP to 70% of global GDP covered by a net zero commitment. But I think that's going to be very, very important. And finance is going to be absolutely critical. I think this 100 billion figure has become a matter of trust for developing countries. And that's why, for me, it's absolutely vital that we are able to show a delivery path to 100 billion a year over the five-year period from 2020 to 2025. As I said in my opening remarks, we're working on a delivery plan being put together with our colleagues in the German and Canadian government, where we hope it may be possible to demonstrate the funding that is coming from sovereigns, the funding that is being mobilized from the private sector as a result of public funding going in, the funding coming from multilateral development banks, and any other finance mobilization that is taking place. What we did see at the G7 leaders, we did see additional new money coming from Germany. We saw new money coming from Canada and from Japan. And the UK, of course, also committed back in 2019 that we would double our international climate finance commitment. But clearly, we need all of the G7 to come forward with more money. And indeed, in that communique that I referred to, there was a clear agreement that there would be further funding coming forward in terms of climate finance. And I think the final piece is bringing this back, of course, to effectively the real economy as well. So we are very much driving the push on the end of unabated coal use, the end of international financing for coal. And again, we've made some progress. All the G7 have now agreed no more international coal financing from this year. South Korea has done the same. We need all countries that are financing coal to do the same. And in terms of zero emission vehicles as well, you know, we want to see countries come forward with commitments to have only new sale of vehicles. The UK, of course, is committed that from 2030, we will only have the sale of electric vehicles in the UK. And you know, I think the other sort of big issue has been on afforestation. We want to see more sort of policies coming forward in terms of tackling deforestation that is going on around the world, and of course sustainable agriculture. And in each of these three policy areas, we have set up mechanisms whereby governments around the world are able to come together and have that discussion. We have a zero emissions vehicles transition council, an energy transition council as part of COP, and also on agriculture. And clearly in our presidency year, which will not start until November, which will then have a year to run, we will take forward a lot of these issues as well. And I think it's in our opportunity to drive forward a lot of the, if I can put it like this, the real economy changes that also need to happen to deliver on the commitments that governments are making.
Thank you very much for that. You touched on the importance of the financial support, and some of my colleagues will follow up on that shortly. You also mentioned that obviously we then have a year following COP immediately to look at what the outcomes are. And I guess that's my next question, looking at the implementation stage, what happens after COP26 and the agreements reached at COP26. And I guess there are two elements to my question. First of all, how will the UK government take forward the outcomes agreed at COP26 in terms of new strategy or legislation? And secondly, from a global perspective, do you have an expectation that the UK net zero strategy and any new climate targets agreed at UK level and a Scottish Government level will set the template for other nations to follow?
Yeah, so I think, you know, I've obviously had a lot of international engagement over the past year. And I can say to you that I think people around the world do see the UK as a leader on green growth. In fact, I mean, if you look at energy, you know, we've now got the biggest offshore wind sector in the world, and we have taken the use of coal in the UK energy mix from 40% in 2012 to less than 2% now. And by the end of 2024, there'll be no more coal in our electricity mix. And you know, we were the first country, major economy, to legislate for net zero. We've got a really ambitious NDC ourselves. We've got a very ambitious sixth carbon budget target as well. So I think we are setting the template. And I have to say to you, Chair, that during 2020, when I was combining this role with my role as base Secretary of State, I spent a lot of time trying to persuade countries to come forward with more ambitious NDCs. And, you know, I was always politely told that, you know, they were quite looking forward to seeing what the UK was going to do itself. And we did, in December, set out a very ambitious NDC, and I think that has allowed us to speak with some authority on this particular issue. In terms of what we do during our presidency year, you know, obviously we are planning on that at the moment, and I've given you some of the elements that we want to drive forward. But I want to say to you that we will be an active presidency. Obviously, COP27 will be held in an African nation, there is always a lot of liaison that takes place between the presidency that is handing over to the new ones. And we will, of course, then work very closely with whoever in Africa is awarded the COP27.
Thank you very much for that. Let me bring in Deputy Convener Fiona Hislop.
Good morning, Mr. Sharma, and best wishes for a successful COP26. Following up your comments there about leadership and ambition, obviously Scotland has a great deal of ambition, and indeed UK will not be able to meet their targets unless Scotland meets ours and vice versa. So in looking at COP26, I'm interested in your advice as to how we can secure whole of UK input into COP26, what you think we've got best to offer in terms of demonstration, yes, on offshore renewables, but also on just transition. And I was struck by what you said about G20 countries. We know from Professor Richard Skia that the IPCC is interested in our approach on just transition, and particularly in reference to coal. Perhaps that might be a helpful platforming that may be useful at COP26.
Great. Well, Fiona, if I may, I mean, it was a pleasure to work with you previously on these issues as well. So I'm very pleased we're having this conversation. I've been very clear on this right from the start, is that we want to see this as showcasing what the UK is doing. You will know, because you were part of the grouping, that we have a devolved administrations ministerial group that I chair, which brings together the minister is responsible for these issues from all the devolved administrations, together with ministers from Welsh, Scottish and Northern Ireland offices as well. In fact, the last meeting that we had was yesterday. I have to say, I think the collaboration on the logistics and planning has been actually really good. With the Scottish Government, with Glasgow City Council, it's worked really well. And Peter Hill, who is Chief Executive of COP26, also chairs the Delivery Board, and he may want to add a little bit more about that close working. But in terms of showcasing the UK, you will know that the venue is going to be divided into the Green Zone, which is effectively open to the public. And we had a significant levels of expressions of interest from businesses, from NGOs, academia, etc., to display in the Green Zone. And we did liaise with all the devolved administrations in terms of, you know, the submissions of interest that came in. And we are going to have, we are going to be showcasing, from a sort of Scottish perspective, I think quite a number of Scottish-led initiatives in the Green Zone. In terms of the Blue Zone, what we have said is that we are going to have quite a lot of focus on the region, cities, the built environment day at COP. There's a theme day every day, and on that day there will be a focus on the devolved administrations. But as I made very clear yesterday in my conversations with the ministers, is that we set out for them more detail of what we plan to discuss on each of these days over that two-week period, and I've asked them to come back to me and my officials on how they might want various devolved administrations to be involved. And thirdly, I think in terms of the UK pavilion itself as well, we're having a discussion about how we can showcase in the UK pavilion the work that is going on across the devolved nations.
Can I maybe focus a bit on policy aspects? Now, clearly, in terms of delivery and your role over the coming year, post the actual COP26, the issue of delivery is going to be very important globally. And so, therefore, states will have to work with sub-states in terms of that actual delivery. And that is where the good cooperation between Scotland and the UK would be really, really important in showcasing what can be done and should be done because of that dependency in terms of targets, etc., that we talked about previously. So is that an opportunity for, again, Scotland to help on a global stage to show how sub-states can deliver on energy targets?
Well, yeah, I mean, I hope we will see all of this. And I said that's why I'm very keen that we get further feedback from all of the devolved administrations on the plans that we showed them yesterday in terms of detail of what is going to be discussed on each of the days. What we've set out so far publicly is the theme on each particular day, so whether it's energy or transport or regions. And I think there will be an opportunity for the devolved administrations to showcase what they're doing. I think you raised a very, very important wider point here about net zero strategy. Now, obviously, the UK government has been pretty clear that we will set out a net zero strategy before COP26. There's a lot of detailed work that's going on that. And obviously, there is a lot of liaison that takes place between BEIS colleagues and colleagues in the devolved administrations. And obviously, there's an interministerial group that's been set up, which I think is working well. And I don't know, with your permission, Chair, if I could invite Lee McDonough to just come in and say a little bit about that domestic working arrangement, which I think is so vitally important.
Yes, please.
Thank you, CPD. So yes, as just referenced, with default administration counterparts, BEIS has established an inter-ministerial group. It covers net zero, energy and climate change. And it meets bi-monthly and brings together ministers from the four administrations, basically to discuss emission reduction efforts across the UK. And so that's at the ministerial level. We've had really constructive engagements, but that's backed up by a really significant and quite extensive official level set of engagements as well between BEIS and the devolved administrations. At senior official level, we have something called the Net Zero Nations Board. And at working level, we have a whole load of working groups that support that. And the Net Zero Nations Board, again, meets bi-monthly. It's chaired by a senior BEIS official. It met four times last year to cover a whole range of issues, deep dives across the majority of the policy areas that are in the strategy.
Thank you. And thank you, Alec. I'll ask Convener to move on. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Fiona. I believe Mark Ruskell has a supplemental in this area. Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Convener, and good morning to you all. I wanted to ask you about the UK government's engagement in the Beyond Oil and Gas Alliance, where this is an initiative being led by the Danish government, but seems to be building up quite ahead of steam. We've now got Germany, Iceland, Costa Rica, Belize, Portugal, Netherlands, Ireland, New Zealand, that are all engaging in the work of the alliance. Can I ask you what the conversations have been so far with the Danish government about this, and how you intend to engage in this conversation that will be launched at COP26 in Glasgow?
Well, there are obviously sort of a range of conversations that are taking place, and I think in terms of you know, what our domestic policy is going to be on oil and gas, I think we've been pretty clear on this. The government is going to, has already set out that there will be a climate compatibility checkpoint that will assess any future licenses for oil and gas. I think the intention is to set out more details on this at the end of this year, and perhaps Lee might, from a BEIS perspective, want to elaborate on that. You know, obviously we are having a sort of whole range of conversations across a range of policy areas, and I was in Copenhagen some months ago. I had a meeting with ministers, the Prime Minister as well, discussing, as I said, a range of issues. But I know, Lee, if you wanted to comment, because ultimately this comes down to domestic policy, if you wanted to comment on this.
Yes, thank you. As you referenced, we do and have publicly committed to introducing a climate compatibility checkpoint. It was announced earlier this year and will be in place by the end of 2021. And this will be used to assess the climate compatibility of future licensing rounds. And our current thinking is it should basically look at industry progressing in the different commitments in the North Sea transition deal, how the UK compares to other oil and gas producers in terms of reducing emissions associated with production, and whether the UK continues to need domestic production to reduce our dependency on imports. And we'll be going out to seek views on the checkpoint shortly. So that is the plan, to be in place by the end of the year.
Thanks very much, Mark. I believe Jackie Dunbar has a supplemental in relation to the UK government and the Scottish government working together on COP.
Yes, good morning, Mr. Sharma. I think it was touched on briefly, but could you maybe go into a bit more detail about how you think the UK government are liaising with the Scottish government to achieve an ambitious global deal? Are there any areas that we're overlapping, and and how much cooperation is there?
Yeah, thank you. So I think I think it's worth saying, all colleagues will know this, but I mean, this COP is quite different from Paris. In Paris, it was very clear that there was, you know, effectively one agreement that we were trying to reach. Here, what we have is a number of strands. As I said, one is on mitigation, as the chair said, you know, the NDCs and net zero commitments. We're asking for adaptation communications to come forward. We are asking for finance. And then, of course, you know, closing off those elements of the Paris rulebook, which, you know, ultimately there are officials within the UK government who are very involved in those negotiations as well with countries around the world. And all of this will obviously come together in cover decisions coming out of COP and anything that comes out of the World Leaders Summit, which obviously takes place in the first 2 days of COP. And, you know, collectively what this will hopefully do is to be able to demonstrate that we have kept 1.5 within reach. So I think, you know, where we have colleagues are able to, how can I put it like this, sort of encourage policy changes elsewhere, NDCs, of course, that's welcomed. But in a way, there are so many sort of strands that we are trying to tie together here. And a lot of that will come down, of course, to the negotiations as well in the final 2 weeks. And as I said, we've got a negotiating team in the UK government that's been beavering away on this for quite some time now, talking to their counterparts internationally.
Can I just further ask another quick question? What advice would you give to the Scottish Government and the Parliament on how they can play their part in a successful conference? And what role do you think the First Minister can play in this?
Yeah, well, let me take the First Minister issue first. So, Prime Minister Johnson has said that he wants all the First Ministers to play an important part. And you know, there is work going on at official level looking on this. As I've said, you know, very clearly, we want this to be a whole of UK approach. And I'm sure that, you know, shortly you will hear more from the UK government on this issue. But I said this is something that the Prime Minister leads on. I think in terms of the involvement of others in government from the devolved administrations, there has always been the precedence that as part of the UK delegation, we also have representation from ministers in the devolved administrations. That will absolutely happen again. In fact, we are in detailed discussions right now, which each of the devolved administrations in terms of numbers of people who would join the UK delegation. And I think the third strand of this is parliamentarians. So, you know, shortly we're going to be communicating with the presiding officers in each of the DAs in terms of, you know, suggesting how members of those legislatures are able to come to COP, get access on the days that they want to the blue zone. And we also have a globe which, as all colleagues will be aware, is organising an event in the Scottish Parliament, I think, on the 5th and 6th of November, which is going to bring together international parliamentarians internationally as well. And I think that's an opportunity for, frankly, you know, all parliamentarians, whichever legislature they sit in the UK, to also get involved as well.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jackie. Let me bring in Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Just taking you back, Mr. Sharma, if I may, you mentioned the nationally determined contributions earlier and the need to mobilise international financial support to assist developing countries to meet those NDCs following COP26. Now, regardless of whether the amount ultimately agreed is $100 billion or otherwise, can you tell us how will this financial support be administered, allocated and shared with those countries most in need of support to meet their targets, please?
Yeah. So, obviously, if, as I said, we're putting together a delivery plan where we will put in place or demonstrate how much money is coming from individual governments, how much money is being mobilised from the private sector as a result of the public money that's gone in from individual governments, how much is coming from the multilateral development banks and any other finance that's being mobilised. So if I take the UK government, you know, we've got a significant international climate finance commitment, and we will allocate finance to individual projects around the world, and that will be the approach that other sovereign nations take as well as you know, the multilateral development banks as well have targets for how much they want to put in terms of funding into climate projects as well. So those decisions will be made within either those governments or indeed in those multilateral development banks. But what we want to see and be able to demonstrate is that there is a quantum of money which equates to $100 billion a year from 2020 to 2025, which credibly developing nations can look at and say, yes, we can see where that financing is going to come from. And I think it is actually a very good mechanism. So we are right now in discussions with individual governments, with multilateral development banks. I've been having lots of those discussions to get their forward figures as well, so we can see what is likely to come forward. As I said, I think this is a key element of this. I mean, that there are two key issues we want to make sure. One is that the finance is delivered, and secondly, that the mitigation targets come forward as well. And I think what some developing countries will say is that without finance, it's going to be pretty challenging.
Thank you very much. A second question, again, sticking with the financing, if I may. If we look at the UK government's financing to reach climate change targets, so the Climate Change Committee, I think, has estimated that an extra £50 billion a year of capital expenditure is going to be needed from 2030. Does the UK government take any view on whether that estimate is reasonable? And in any event, can you help us understand how will that be financed?
Yes, sorry. I think your reference is effectively to the cost of going net zero domestically. Is that right?
Yes. The report from the Climate Change Committee, yes.
Yeah. So I think if you look at, I think the first thing I'd say to you, and this is a more sort of general point, a global point, it is that the cost of inaction on climate change is most definitely greater than the cost of action. And you will have be familiar with the Stern review that came out a few years ago, authored by Lord Stern, who obviously sits in the House of Lords, but is a eminent economist, who said that the global cost to the global economy of unabated climate change is anywhere between 5 and 20% of global GDP. In terms of what we have said, and I'll ask Lee to come in, because I guess this comes down to sort of domestic issues as well. I think what we've said is around under 2%, and obviously there's a net zero review that is undergoing, and the Treasury will be setting out more details of that before COP26. But interestingly, what the CCC said is back in, I think, 2015, they had a report which said that the cost of the move to net zero was around 2% of GDP. In their latest report, which came out last year, I think it was anywhere between 1 to 2%. And the reason that they said that the cost was falling was because the pace at which renewables technology and other technology was developing, and the price of that was coming down significantly. So if you look at the price of offshore wind around the world, including, of course, in the UK, if you look at solar, there have been significant drops. I think in terms of solar, 80% drop in prices over a 10-year period. I think when we talk about costs, we also have to look at what the upside is. And on a UK-wide basis, through successive governments, we have, on a 30-year period, managed to grow the UK economy by almost 80% in terms of GDP, but also cut emissions by over 40%. So I think we are seen actually around the world as a country that's demonstrated that green growth is possible. And I think we also have to take into account all the other sort of benefits of having a cleaner environment in terms of the impact on people's health and well-being as well. But I don't know, Lee, whether you may be a little bit closer on this from a base perspective, but I don't know whether you wanted to comment at all on overall costs of net zero.
Thank you, CPD. I mean, you basically said what you said is correct in terms of the headline figures. And I would just say some of our most important work that we're undertaking at the moment is on the cost of transition. And you're right, low carbon investment needs to scale up to around £50 billion each year to deliver net zero and support the UK's economic recovery. And this investment generates, substantial fuel savings as cleaner, more efficient technologies replace their fossil fuel predecessors. And in time, these savings cancel out the investment cost entirely. And a new piece of insight from our work means our central estimate for costs is now below 1% of GDP through the next 30 years. And if I could just add, in terms of the sort of domestic focus, obviously, you know, we're looking at here a combination of public and private investments, and the sort of relationship between the two components, I think, varies depending on the stage at which sectors are at. And so, you know, a large part of our strategy, which we'll publish ahead of COP, you know, and you will have seen in some of the strategies that have been published recently, so the hydrogen strategy or the industrial decarbonisation strategy, focus on where government needs to step in to provide transition support to help industry develop and invest in the technology that we need to see in order to meet our targets. Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you for such a full answer, which I found fascinating, if I'm honest. The final thing, Convener, if I may, just one more question to pick up on something that the Director General mentioned earlier. The UK is the, so a slight change of topic, if I may, the UK is the first G7 country to agree the North Sea transition deal, which I think is worth between about 16 and 18 billion pounds. Now, and I think that's leveraged private investment, which will support the oil and gas industry transition to a clean, green energy and support jobs. Now, within that deal, the sector has committed to cut emissions by about 50% by 2030, and the government, the sector, the unions are going to work to deliver the skills, innovation and infrastructure to decarbonise North Sea production. So the question begged is, will COP26 have any impact on the transition deal, or does it remain as is?
Well, Lee, do you want to sort of take this from a domestic perspective? I can talk a little bit more internationally.
Yeah. So I think the transition deal, as you've mentioned, you know, as we said, it's a global exemplar. And, you know, that deal has been struck domestically in terms of, you know, the government and relative industries. And, you know, it does include supporting up to 40,000 high-quality direct and indirect supply chain jobs and generating up to 16 billion of investments, as you've quite rightly flagged, up to 2030. And, you know, the really good thing about the deal as well, you know, it, the commitments in the deal achieve, we think, 60 megatons reduction in UK greenhouse gas emissions. And so that includes the commitment that you referred to from industry to sort of reduce down emissions to 50% by 2030. And, you know, COP, I think the COP link to it, so that deal exists. The COP link can be to showcase what we've done here. And so, you know, be an exemplar to other countries and, you know, show them how we can do that just transition, making sure we're protecting supply chains and jobs and transitioning to, you know, support low carbon industry and technologies.
Point. I think the issue of just transition is something that I think, you know, every country is facing. And when I've you know, spoken to other governments, this is something that they all you know, absolutely get. And so, for instance, when I was in Spain, you know, there was a discussion about how the government working with the trade unions was looking also at the issues on just transition. So in the same way that the UK has a Green Jobs Task Force where, you know, trade unions are also represented. And I think this is a key element of this. You know, I think if we are, not just from a UK perspective, but internationally, if we're going to deliver green growth, it has to be in a manner that also means that those who are in sectors where jobs are reducing are able to get the skills and the support to move into new jobs. And I think that is a sort of critical issue that actually every country faces right now.
Very grateful, thank you.
Thanks very much, Liam. Monica Lennon to be followed by Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Sharma. I wholeheartedly agree with you that COP26 is an opportunity to showcase what the UK has to offer. With the IPCC report warning that the door is closing on 1.5, would rejecting the new Cambo oil field ahead of COP26 be a strong example of the climate leadership that the global community is looking for? And perhaps a second point that your officials could pick up. Will new oil and gas developments be reassessed in light of the recent IPCC and IEA reports? And if so, will this include an economic analysis, including carbon dioxide costs of the Cambo field and others, as proposed by Professor Jim Skia from the Just Transition Commission?
Thank you for that question. I think in terms of Cambo itself, this is obviously now a domestic policy issue that sits with Bay. So I'll leave it to Lee to sort of give further details on this. I would just point out one thing is that this was, of course, a license for this field was originally awarded, I think, back in 2001. What we have been very clear about is in terms of future licenses and for them to be compatible with our climate law, the fact that we're going to net zero by 2050. There's obviously been a public inquiry on Cambo, and I think maybe at this point, rather than speak for Bayes, I pass to Lee to talk in any more detail she wants on Cambo.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I lost connection for a second. So I guess you were just asking about where we were in the licensing process. So, as CPG just said, the license for the Cambo oil field was granted in 2001. And the developer has now requested to move to the production phase, which is requires a consent in order for that to happen, and therefore the next stage of the process was just a thorough assessment of the potential environmental impacts, a public consultation, and scrutiny by the Oil and Gas Authority is underway. No decision has been made yet on that process. And so I can't really say any more about it other than to reiterate the point that CPD made. Development for proposals for fields that have existing licenses are subject to a really rigorous process. So an environmental impact assessment, as I said, a public consultation, as well as that scrutiny from the Oil and Gas Authority before consent is provided. And all future licences will only be granted on the basis that they are compatible with the climate compatibility checkpoints that we referenced earlier, which will come into effect at the end of this year. And we'll be seeking views on the nature of that checkpoint process shortly. Thank you.
Thank you for that response, and apologies if there was a slight technical issue. That brings me perhaps to my second question, and I do sympathise with Mr. Sharma because you've had the role of speaking to people around the world, and that has involved a lot of travel, which you've been criticised for, but we perhaps can sympathise with why the in-person meetings can be more efficient. I just wondered, Mr. Sharma, has all that travel and face-to-face negotiation, has it been worth it? What have been the key achievements from that? And if I can, because I think we all have high hopes for COP26, but can I ask, what are your fears about COP26? And on that note, is there anything about the conference that is keeping you awake at night?
Yes, what's keeping me awake at night? I think quite a lot, obviously, in terms of this. We're less than 2 months to go. And, this is, I have to say, I don't think it's an exaggeration to say that, COP26 is our last best chance of getting this right. And, this is a decisive decade. All colleagues asking questions on this committee have made reference to the IPCC report. And that's why we need to get this right at COP. In terms of my travel, I think those face-to-face discussions actually have been incredibly vital in terms of building the personal relationships. It has meant that we're able to have, more fruitful discussions. And if I take some sort of examples, I've been to South Korea on two occasions, and we've had a very good announcement coming out of South Korea in terms of ending international co-financing. That is an issue that, from a UK perspective, we of course have been raising with South Korea, and I'm absolutely delighted that commitment has come forward. I was in Japan ahead of Prime Minister Suga announcing Japan's NDC, and I was very clear both in meetings with him and ministers as well as in the public about the fact that we wanted to see Japan get to 50% NDC. And when the announcement came, they had a range of sort of 46, but with an ambition for 50. So I think, I could go on with a sort of list of things just to be very clear, this isn't sort of just me, this is a whole team which has been working over a long period of time on these issues. And the fact that, we have gone from less than 30% of the global economy with a net zero target to 70%, I do think that's something that the UK can say that we have helped to come forward with. In terms of, and by the way, the only other thing I would say to you is that in terms of COP itself, and we may come into that discussion, but I've been very clear right from the start that this has to be a physical event. And that is what I've heard from countries around the world as well. Particularly for developing nations, those climate vulnerable nations, they want to sit at the same table with the big developed nations, with the big emitters, and look them in the eye. Ultimately, this is a negotiation amongst almost 200 countries, and that is why it needs to happen in physical form. In terms of my concerns, I just reiterate what I said at the start of this session, which is that I want to see the biggest emitters coming forward with those emission reduction targets that are going to take us to a point where we can say we've kept 1.5 alive. I do want to see the money come to the table. I do want to see the donor nations pony up the cash. And ultimately, there are a number of outstanding but pretty complex issues from the Paris rulebook that we also need to get resolved. And this is a little bit like playing a incredibly complicated game of chess. I think I said to someone on the media, this is sort of multidimensional chess, and it was pointed out that doesn't exist. But I can tell you, it feels a little bit like that.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Monica. Mark Ruskell to be followed by Colette Stevenson.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. If I can just come back to the points made about how UK policy on oil and gas is perhaps evolving. Particularly in terms of how you stay aligned with the Paris Agreement. I'm wondering actually if that policy of maximum economic recovery actually puts the oil and gas companies in quite a difficult position. If I was on the board of Shell, and I'm not on the board of Shell, by the way, but if I was, I'd be faced with, on one hand, a ruling from the Dutch court, which says that as a company we have to reduce our emissions by 45%, and not just in terms of production, but in terms of sale of all fossil fuels. On the other hand, if I have a license under maximum economic recovery, I have a legal obligation under UK law to extract every single last drop from those reserves that are licensed. Can you see the difficulty here in terms of making that transition under the current policy of maximum economic recovery? And if you do see that, how do you see that policy changing over time?
Yeah, well, let me just, so I think the first thing I'd say is that when I was still at Bayes, we put out an energy white paper, which showed, how we were going to effectively move forward to 2050 in terms of our energy mix. And I think that still assumed that there would be, under various scenarios, you could still see some oil and gas. And in fact, I think, the IEA put out a report recently, which, in fact, I asked if they would put this out and work on, where they showed what needed to happen in terms of the world moving to net zero by 2050. And even as part of that, there was some element of oil and gas, significantly reduced, of course, but some element of oil and gas in the global energy mix. But I don't know, Lee, if you want to talk specifically from a domestic perspective in terms of this particular tension that Mr. Ruskell has referred to.
Thank you. You framed it perfectly. So we're doing a huge amount, as you know, to drive down demand for fossil fuels. But there is going to be a continued ongoing demand for oil and gas over the coming years. And that's been recognised, as CPD said, by the International Climate Change Committee. And that is the case. And so, you know, the UK continental shelf is a mature oil and gas basin, and production is declining. And we expect the rate of decline to be broadly in line with our domestic demand as we transition to cleaner sources of energy. And you referenced sort of previously licensed fields such as Cambo. They are already accounted for in terms of projected production and emissions, estimated emissions, and therefore we're confident that they can be developed if they get through the process that we talked about earlier in terms of the degree of scrutiny to be given a consent. So we're confident that they could still go ahead, and as we seek to achieve our commitments to net zero in 2050. I'll stop there.
That suggests that there's some need for oil and gas going forward, but that's not the same thing as maximum economic recovery, is it? I mean, that's not the same as 20 billion barrels of oil and gas in the North Sea. That might be, you know, somewhere south of 6 billion barrels. Would you not acknowledge that?
I think we're probably sort of getting into some of the sort of detailed domestic policy here. But if I may just make a sort of a more general point on this, is that, you know, we are, if you look at the projections that have been put out there for 2050, we're looking sort of 30 years ahead. We have seen globally what happens when, for instance, renewable energy, clean energy is mobilized at pace and scale. What happens in terms of price? I mean, there are various scenarios that people have in terms of what the global energy mix might look like. And I think that is also something that, and I just be clear, I'm not here speaking on behalf of the oil and gas majors, they speak for themselves. But if you look at what some of those companies have been saying about moving to being sort of effectively being energy providers rather than, you know, oil and gas, I think there is a companies as to what, you know, how the world is changing. I mean, I don't know, I've got Peter Hill who's come on. No, Peter, was there anything you wanted to add from a sort of international perspective? Sorry to you just came on my screen. I thought you might want to come in. If not, it's fine.
Yes, I mean, it related to an earlier point, but it's also relevant to the wider oil and gas question. Just to recall that last year the government announced that it would be phasing out support for international oil and gas export credits, etc. And just to say that obviously that's more effective if a number of countries are taking that path. And so we are working with a number of countries who are moving in that direction. There have been some announcements, for example, recently from the United States. So it was related to the broader issue, but just to say that is an area of work that we are prioritising from COP in order to see who is prepared to bring forward their commitments, both in time and substance, recognising that we need to support countries in the transition, but also recognising that that the more countries who can reorientate their financial and guarantee support from the oil and gas sector to the renewables sector, the better. So, as I say, it was relevant to an earlier point, but I think it's still relevant to the broader discussion. I was told that R is the thing to put in the chat if you want to come in. And I see that Lee has also put R in the chat, so I just mention it.
Back on this point.
Yes, thank you, Peter. I just wanted to flag, which I should have said earlier, that obviously the Oil and Gas Authority strategy, which has recently been updated, it does place an obligation on industry to support net zero. And so the strategy makes it clear that maximising economic recovery does include a net zero consideration as part of that obligation.
Mark, thank you very much. Let me bring in Colette Stevenson with a brief reminder that we need to finish by 11:30. Colette, please.
Okay, thank you, convener. Good morning, everyone. I'm going to focus on in terms of financing the net zero and based on the consumer and just how do you feel about or should the capital costs of decarbonisation be paid for by the consumer and through electricity bills or gas bills or more widely through taxation or other wider means? And you know, obviously at the heart of this is our consumer, so I'm keen to see how that's going to look going forward.
If I may, I think I'm going to end up intruding on sort of HMT and Bayes policy here if I start commenting on that. But I mean, Lee, I don't know if you feel able to say anything about that. I mean, obviously, the HMT's net zero review is going to be coming out before COP, and people will be able to have a look at that. But was there any other point you wanted to make on this issue of, you know, where the costs fall?
So I think, as you said, CPD, the Treasury's strategy will sort of set out in broad terms the analysis around this whole issue. And then I'll just refer back to the points I made earlier, which is, you know, there's a combination here of public and private investment and obviously, you know, a balance between government support, exchequer support, to depending on the stage that individual sectors are at. And then ultimately, you know, we all share responsibility, including through consumer bills and industry bills to, you know, support our transition. So I don't think it's a sort of one size fits all position. It's a very nuanced issue. And the Treasury's strategy will set out our plans on that front. Thank you.
OK, thank you very much. There's also been touched upon the risk of carbon leakage as well and how it can be mitigated. Can there be an agreement on carbon pricing be reached at COP26?
Yes, I think just to sort of, by the way, I think the point you've raised is incredibly important and pertinent. I think what we're trying to resolve in Glasgow, on the road to enact Glasgow, is Article 6, which is effectively sort of voluntary carbon markets. I think that is separate to perhaps the wider discussion that is going on in terms of carbon border adjustment mechanisms and wider issues on carbon leakage. So I've been very clear not to sort of conflate the two. But there is no doubt that when it comes to the CBAMs, there is a very live discussion that is taking place. You'll have seen the EU early this year set out their initial thoughts on this. But as I said, from a COP26 perspective, you know, this is not a mandated item. What we are trying to resolve is on Article 6. Peter Hill has come back into view. So I don't know, Peter, if there's anything you wanted to add, because you've been having a lot of those discussions as well with the team.
Yeah, no, just to completely support that, I mean, the issue of domestic and international carbon pricing is very lively, and the relation of that to trade issues. I don't think it is, as you say, one, it isn't part of the formal COP agenda, but also I don't think it is yet ripe for, yet ready for that sort of international agreement. But I'm absolutely sure that whether through the G7, the G20 or other fora, that discussion is only going to continue and gather pace in the months and years ahead. Of course, the strongest way of addressing those concerns is by the mitigation action that everybody takes, and that's one of the reasons why it's so important in the next few weeks that all countries, G20 and others, do come up with those plans and those commitments so that these issues are managed, that we can have them in a collaborative and cooperative, they can be discussed in a collaborative and cooperative way. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. That was really useful. Thanks very much.
Thanks very much, Colette. We are reaching the end of this session, so that completes our questions and concludes the evidence session. Let me thank Mr. Sharma and his colleagues once again for their unique insights into COP26. And on behalf of the whole committee, we wish you the very best of luck for a successful outcome at the conference in Glasgow. Thank you very much, and have a great day. That concludes the public evidence session.